Well, I guess we will get started with the first ever Missouri Employers Mutual Safety WebEx. I appreciate everybody jumping on here this morning to do this quick meeting. My name is Mark Woodward. I am the senior loss prevention trainer with the Missouri Employers Mutual. Really appreciate you taking time this morning. I think we're going to run this meeting just kind of quickly. We'll go for 20 to 25 minutes. If you guys have any questions throughout this, feel free to type them in. You know, I'm just going to be kind of going through the PowerPoint presentation that you guys can see in front of you. The focus today is how to conduct a safety meeting, some of the things that we need to remember, and then the importance of these safety meetings. So really appreciate your time. MEM just really appreciate your business as well and your attention to safety. As you know, MEM for the last, well, darn near 20 years has just pushed safety. You know, we have had the WorkSafe program in place for 15, 20 years, and that is the key. Your efforts with safety will result in better workplace productivity and better cost savings. So we're working on this with you today. If you have any questions, do not hesitate to call us. Call me. We'll share that information here a little bit later. As you know, every customer with MEM has access to loss prevention rep, has access to claim services, and what I encourage you to do is to use those services. So we'll talk about those as we go. So how to conduct a safety meeting. Let's get into this. I do roughly 350 safety meetings with our customers a year. I want you to know that anytime you need something, you can call in here and I can help you out. I've had a lot of street experience. My first safety job was with a trucking company. Did lots of safety meetings throughout Missouri with our drivers. I then started working for a manufacturer in the Columbia area, and I did 2 to 3 safety meetings a day with those folks, Saturdays, that kind of thing, to meet the demands. We were a growing organization. When I started with the company, we had 125 people, and then we moved on into around 350 to 400 at the time before I came to MEM. And then when I came to MEM, roughly 7 years ago, I went from 450 people to 14,000 customers. So we've got a lot of experience doing safety meetings. What I want to do is kind of give you some of the street skills behind that. Most folks underestimate the value of face-to-face safety meetings. One of the questions I would ask you is how often are you doing safety meetings now? And you need to look at that, and you need to ask why you're doing the safety meetings in the way you are doing them. A lot of folks will say, we do our safety meetings once a year. And I would question the effectiveness of that. What you need to do is look at your safety efforts and then compare them to your office. How much are you paying out in claims? How many claims are you having? How much are you paying out? How effective is the safety program overall? Then you may determine that, you know what, an annual safety meeting is not enough. Another thing you need to assess is your risk. What is your risk? Do you have people working at heights? Do you have people working with, say, patients in a healthcare setting? Do you have people that drive? Are you in a high risk? Are you in a high risk environment? So that's something that we need to talk about. The value of a safety meeting is that you are able to get in front of your employees in a face-to-face fashion, show sincerity, answer their questions, okay? And, you know, that takes a lot of guts to do that. You have to go face-to-face with your people. And that's how you build a safety culture. That's what we're looking for, a safety culture. You don't need to be a polished public speaker. And the only thing you need to really do is just study your homework a little bit. And what I want to try to do is give you some strategies to making presenting safety information a little bit easier. The face-to-face interaction is very important. We do work with companies that have online training. Online training is fine if you want to do some basics. But remember, you can't push it all off on just a computer program. You need face-to-face interaction. So I recommend if you're going to use online programs to use a mix. You have to build face-to-face interaction. And through that interaction, hopefully you're going to improve safety culture. You're going to improve transparency. One of the things you need to do is make sure that whatever you talk about is on paper. If you have an expectation, get it on paper. Clear up all of the gray areas. And then you've got to show sincerity. People will not believe it. People won't believe it if you're not sincere about the message. So moving ahead, let's go to the second slide. One of the things we really believe is that safety helps protect your workforce and it protects your bottom line. We do safety because we want to protect people. Yeah, we understand that. We want to save lives. There's that basic human thing, that humanity, that we want to protect people. But let's face it, we have a business to run. And we have to pay attention to the bottom line. How much are we spending in insurance? How much is it hurting us? Where can we save money? One of the things you need to do is know your carrier resources. Okay, how can MEM help? What can we do to help you do safety meetings? Okay, so that's one thing. You can always call us. We can send you material. Okay. You need to focus on losses. Okay, so don't do safety meetings for the sake of just doing safety meetings. Okay, don't waste your time. Don't waste anybody else's time. Your safety meetings need to have a positive effect. Okay, so what are your losses? We need to write that down. You need to determine what your losses are. Go back through your work comp history. Go back through your first aid log. Go back through your complaints. Okay, go back through these things and create a direction with regard to losses. What negative events have happened on the plant floor that you need to talk to people about? Second thing we need to do is look at your risk. What is the risk? You may not have had losses. Okay, you may not have that many losses, but you need to look at your risk. If you drive vehicles, that is a giant risk. That is huge. Slip, trip, fall, hazardous contact with equipment or machines, that is pinched fingers, cut fingers, things dropped on toes. Okay, so we need to focus on losses and risk. You need to determine, well, what is an appropriate time to do a safety meeting, okay? One of the things I do is I try to work with supervisors. If they have a busy day, I understand that. Now, that can also be an excuse and a crutch, okay? So we have analyzed risk. We've analyzed losses. Now it's time to deploy the safety meetings. We need to pick something. We need to pick a top risk. We need to pick a top loss. We need to go out there and gather our information. Then we need to select a time. Everybody needs to kind of agree on this time. Now, be careful. Like I said, time is sort of a crutch. Supervisors will naturally say, oh, I'm too busy. Well, that's a natural thing. Everybody's going to say that. But what you want to do is make sure that even though you're busy, we still may need to do this safety meeting. Okay, so we want to go ahead and carve out time, but you also want to, you want to work with them. Maybe they are having an extraordinarily busy day, that kind of thing. Annual meetings, in my opinion, as a safety training guy, I don't think they're enough. Annual meetings just aren't enough. You have to stay in front of your people. You have to continually push a safety message. You have to have a safety culture. Monthly meetings may be more appropriate depending on your risk. If you have people doing lots of dangerous stuff like construction, carpentry, heavy manufacturing, driving, if they have exposure to serious strain, then your risk may dictate that you may be needing to do a safety meeting every 2 weeks. In some cases, they will do safety meetings on a daily basis. We recommend that for construction contractors. You guys know that with construction, every day is different. The job site changes every day. The weather changes every day. The ground conditions change every day. And you need to keep on top of folks because in construction, there aren't very many injuries. There's a lot of fatalities. So that's something to think about. And when we look at the bottom line, another thing you need to assess is what are your what is your score with regard to work comp insurance? Work comp insurance is your most expensive insurance. Where are you currently at? Some things you need to do. Right now, how many open work comp claims do you have? Well, hopefully none. But you need to know how many you have open right now, and you need to know the status of each open claim. Now, that takes some recon work every week. You need to call in here to NEM. Where are we at on these claims? Okay, so you need to know these things. You need to know what your EMOD rate is, your experience modifier rate. Some folks know what they are, some don't. You need to know what that rate is. Anybody that's generating premium over $3,500 a year or $7,000 over 2 years is going to have an EMOD rate. The EMOD rate is unique to work comp insurance. If the EMOD rate is over 1, you're quite simply losing money. For example, if you have a 1.15 EMOD rate, you're basically paying 15%, the 0.15, you're paying 15% more for your work comp insurance than your competitor. Because we don't compare roofers against librarians or librarians against firefighters. We compare firefighters against firefighters and roofers against roofers. And also we compare like-sized roofers. Okay. So you're probably losing money if you're over 1. If you're under 1, that's fine, but you're not out of the woods. If you're under 1, that's great. Let's say you're at a 0.85. Well, now you're saving 15%. The problem now is, how do we keep that? How do we keep you saving money? We're not going to sit back here and just say that we're successful. We have to keep it there. Once you go over 1, it changes how underwriting looks at your account. It changes how they bill you. It changes how much they're going to bill you. So something to think about. So protecting the bottom line. We're focusing on losses. We're focusing on risk, and we're going to focus on reducing cost through improved safety culture. And the one true key thing is sincerity and face-to-face interaction with your people. We're going to do that. Okay? Moving ahead, let's flip some slides here. Building a safety culture. You'll see up there low preparation required. I don't want you to take that wrong. Yeah, you are going to have to do some homework, but one of the things you have to remember is there's plenty of information online, plenty of material online. MEMsWorkSafeCenter.com, you can check out that website. There's tons of materials. We have our top business classes up there in our drop-down arrows, plenty of information online. You know, 10, 15 years ago, you had to recreate the wheel. You had to sit there and type all this stuff out, and you had to. You know, people that weren't safety experts had to suddenly become safety experts. Anybody can do a safety meeting. It just takes a little bit of time, just a little time, to rehearse. Now, one of the things you have to do is don't forget about sincerity. The point of you doing these safety meetings is to keep people from getting hurt, to save the company bottom line. If you save the bottom line, we all get to come back to work tomorrow. It makes things easier. Production goes up. That's your sincerity. That's the main thing. People have to see that. Then you have to prepare a little bit of content. So OSHA.gov, WorkSafe Center, YouTube. YouTube has tons of stuff out there on it for safety meetings. Okay? Raises awareness about hazards or safer work practices. When you look at overall company training, are all of your employees getting the same message? Well, probably not. That's natural within the company. It's very difficult for companies to have a common word that they share with everybody, and it gets delineated down through different departments, that kind of thing, evenly. Sometimes it's difficult to do that. So what we have to do is continue to push a commonality with your safety message. Maybe somebody doesn't know the best work practice. Maybe a supervisor doesn't know. So that's what we're going to do. We're raising awareness about slip, trip, falls, vehicle crashes, strains, sprain injuries. We're making sure everybody's on the same page. Instructed by management. That's a big one. I'm a believer in the fact that not just the safety coordinator, not just the human resources coordinator, not just the business owner needs to be, they're not the ones responsible for all the safety needs. Why can't a supervisor do it? Why can't a middle manager do it? Because if they do it, then your employees are more likely to listen to them, for one, because they report to them anyway. But two, it helps prove safety. It helps build safety culture. Everybody's buying in. All the managers are buying in. We always look for top management support, management commitment. Okay? But you do, that means all managers. So, you know, what I would recommend is maybe the safety coordinator do a couple of meetings. Maybe the HR manager, you know, does a couple of meetings. Maybe a couple of the frontline supervisors do a couple of meetings. Okay? And we definitely encourage business owners or plant managers, that kind of thing, to do a safety meeting as well. Okay? But one of the things we want to do is I want to make it easy on you. A lot of people say, wow, we do all these things. We have all these hazards. Where do I focus? Well, focus on losses. Okay? Focus on what your risk is. Don't just do safety meetings for the sake of doing safety meetings. Make sure it fits and it's appropriate. Okay? Face-to-face interactions, very important. You will have to answer some difficult questions, but you will also uncover unsafe situations that you may not know about. You've all been in these situations where people start to talk about things that they didn't necessarily know what they were talking about, and you're sitting there thinking, wow, I'm really glad they mentioned that. You're going to start uncovering things during these safety meetings. So you're talking about safety best practices. You're exhibiting sincerity, you're doing these things, but you're also receiving feedback. And you're starting to uncover things like management inefficiencies, maintenance inefficiencies, problems with communications will all start to come out when you have a good face-to-face interaction. Okay? Moving ahead to the next slide, meeting recommendations. First bullet point, prepare and know the topic. Okay? Prepare and know the topic. Take a few, you know, you may need to spend an hour or so on this. You also may need to spend a little bit of time thinking about work methods. You also need to figure out how the safety message actually fits in with how work gets done. Okay? How does work actually get done, and how is your safety message going to fit into that work? How is it going to improve both processes? Okay? Keep to the point. You need to honor people's time. That was a mistake I made as a safety trainer early on. You get into it, and I'm a safety geek, if you will, and I get into the topic and I have fun. But I would forget. You know, people need to get back to work. They have demands. They have production demands. So you want to keep to the point. Don't veer off topic. Okay, honor people's time. Provide real and usable information. Okay. Don't throw out things that aren't going to be usable, okay, because that's not helpful. In fact, it just confuses people. What you need to do is figure out how your safety recommendations fit into the work process. Just for example, we have seen companies develop a cell phone distracted driving policy. So they develop the cell phone distracted driving policy, and they go out there and they talk to the employees, and they figure out, you know, they tell the employees, don't ever use your cell phone while the vehicle's in motion. Don't ever use it. I don't care if it's personal use. I don't care if you're calling your husband or your wife or your kids. Don't ever use it. Stop the vehicle. And in that meeting, the safety coordinator or the business manager figures out, because everybody starts yelling, yeah, but the office calls me. The office calls me, and they yell at me if I don't pick up the phone. Okay? So you'll start to see things where we have a policy in place, but you start to learn things like, this is what works against the policy. So whenever you're talking about that, you need to look at all of the stakeholders that are involved in this process when you're providing that usable, real safety information. Okay, maintain eye contact, you know that, all the basics there, and then be ready for questions. Now, when I say be ready for questions, one of the things I look at is, you know, with regard to safety, you start to move people's cheese. Okay, let's be honest. They have a certain way of things, a certain way they do things. Okay, let's say a seatbelt policy. You have an employee that wants to say, well, I heard seatbelts kill more people than they actually save. You know, you start to get these questions. Be ready for those. Okay, be ready for any process change questions. Be ready to answer those and be ready to take notes. That's a big thing, too. Okay, moving ahead, take attendance. One of the things we encourage here is good attendance, good record keeping. That helps you from an OSHA and compliance standpoint. Okay, if you use a PowerPoint, okay, go ahead and staple that to your attendance records. Okay, in Missouri, there can be a 50% penalty if employees are found to be breaking safety rules and they are subsequently injured. MEM takes a safety penalty, but you have to have good records. Review and provide copies of procedures. Same thing, be transparent. Make photocopies, give it to them, give them the procedure. Review expectations and how policies are going to be enforced. If you do a hard hat safety meeting, and then 2 days later you go out on a job site, nobody's wearing hard hats, that's a problem. So whenever, you know, a safety meeting is also discussing in expectations and how they will be enforced. Okay? So talk to them about it. Say, hey, I'm going to be out there watching you. And MEM could possibly be watching you as well. Moving ahead to the next slide, no risks and losses. Study your work comp history. We've talked about this. I will tell you where we are at from an MEM standpoint. Our number one type of work comp claim that gets submitted here is a slip, trip, fall, followed by strain, sprain due to lifting. Now, that's strain, sprain as a result of lifting. That's different from pushing and pulling. Third one is slip, trip, fall on ice and snow. Well, right now, slip, trip, fall on ice and snow is important. You could be prepping your people. Number four, hazardous contact with objects. Okay, so we have pinched fingers, things getting dropped on hands, severe lacerations, that kind of thing, hands and feet. And the fifth one is vehicle crash. So we want to start out by making these meetings effective. Okay, the average lost workday claim, if you have a lost time claim, is $35,000. So right there, you start out the gate, lost time claim, $35,000, that's your average. And then a fatality is averaging around $500,000 right now. So know these things. Focus on losses. Next slide, time's on your side. Let's be honest with you. Let's be honest. Most adults, they lose interest after about 10 minutes. Okay? Well, that's fine. Let's use that to our advantage. Okay? Get to the point. Okay? Give people real information. Show sincerity. Show you actually care about them. And then what is their natural, and they naturally want to go back to work, okay? Well, a lot of them. After 10 minutes, one of the things I tell people is don't sit there and put people through a four-hour safety meeting. They're naturally going to lose interest. There are some certification programs, things like that, that yes, you're going to need to do that. But when we're talking about building safety culture, showing sincerity, showing people that management cares, making improvements, you know what? You do a bunch of 10-minute safety meetings in a year, you've reached every employee. That's something you need to be proud of. 10 minutes per month per employee gives you 2 hours of training a year. Well, if I came to your plant and said, hey, I need to take everybody off the floor, everybody off the job site for 2 hours on a day, on a production day, there's no way. You'd never be able to do that. But if you could catch them for 10 minutes after break, that is now something that's manageable. You've studied your message, you're ready to answer questions, you're receiving and writing down feedback, you're taking attendance, and you're providing a procedure. You know what? And you do that in 10 minutes, that's a win, okay? But look at how the adult learning styles, look at the adult learning style, okay? Moving ahead, last slide. One of our success stories here at MEM is our video loan program. We have a DVD loaner program. Here at the company, you can get access to this through INET. You can simply email or call into the loss prevention program. We will send you basically a library list of all of our DVDs. We have around 300 or so DVDs that you can, it's like a Netflix. You can just simply email us. We have a contract that you sign basically saying, you know, if it's lost or damaged or stolen or whatever, you know, how we would handle that. We will send you that DVD. You watch it for about 7 or 8 days or 5 days or whatever, and then you send it back, okay? Those users, the folks that use our DVD program average a 0.91 EMOD rate. So if you're routinely using our DVD program to help show, you know, to help with your safety meetings, the folks that are using it are showing success. So we would recommend and encourage you to use our DVD program. Now, it's a huge investment. We did that for our customers. So that's our success story with training. You know, I'm showing 10:27. I don't want to keep you guys too late. Are there any questions that we would have for today? I just wanted to check in with you guys, see if you had any questions. I don't think I see any questions coming up, so we really appreciate your time. We appreciate your business. We're going to start doing more of these WebEx meetings, and if you have any ideas with regard to the topics, we would love to hear those. We appreciate your business, and if there's anything that we can do in the future with regard to training and education or helping you manage your work comp costs better, please let us know. You know, our vision here is to do more of these on a regular basis, and the whole focus here is to help you. So, well, thank you all. I hope it helps. We will see you in the future.